धर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतार वरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः जननीं शारदां देवीं रामकृष्णं जगद्गुरुं पादपद्मे तयोः श्रित्वा प्रणमामि मुहुर्मुहु नमः श्रीयतिराजाय विवेकानन्दसूरये सच्चित्सुखस्वरूपाय स्वामिने तापहारिणे. So we are in the chapter where Saradananda is discussing Sri Ramakrishna's relationship with his own gurus. क्योंकि श्री रामकृष्ण के तो हम लोग गुरु रूपी मानते हैं. He himself is considered a guru and naturally that is how he is well known. But he also had gurus in different ways, just as the Avadhuta had 24 different gurus. From each he learned something different. In the same way, Sri Ramakrishna also learned from each and the gurus. But you know, there is a big difference between normal spiritual aspirants and when someone comes as an avatar purusha. At that time, he not only learns much more than what he learns, he imparts. वो तो अपना तो कुछ शिक्षा तो प्राप्त करेंगे अधिक. Over and above that, he teaches a lot because, you know, in his life, everything, if you study the life of an avatara, everything, there is a kind of a completion, that kind of a fulfillment, purnata, whatever he does. So, you know, if it is to be only one way, Sri Ramakrishna had to learn something, uske liye koi aaye, then, you know, that would only reveal something incomplete in Sri Ramakrishna's life. Unke jivan mein kuch kamti tha. There was something that was lacking. And someone came to fulfill. No, not only that. Why you say the idea of purnata, purnamada, purnamida? Not only that, in turn, the other person also came to be fulfilled. So that, you know, overall there is a total fulfillment in this spiritual union between Sri Ramakrishna and the any number of gurus who came into his life at different times in different ways. So you will find there is a different kind of a mission, there is a different kind of a result in that kind of a meeting. So we saw how Bhairavi Brahmani, who was practicing the, probably was an adept in the Veer Bhav of the Tantras. As you said, Pashu Bhav, Veer Bhav and Divya Bhav. Not so fit for the Divya Bhava probably, which only very rare aspirants like Sri Ramakrishna were fit, because that would demand an extraordinary purity. Because now, unless a person is completely freed from the idea of the body, it's very difficult to practice this Divya Bhava. Divya Bhava doesn't happen at all, because even the most difficult rituals of the Tantras, just as Bhairavi Brahmani brought one young lady and all that, and he said, you sit on her lap and do japa. Within seconds, Ramakrishna went into deep samadhi, just as he started. So like that, you know, that was because his mind was so much immersed in that superconscious, undivided idea all the time. There was, you know, it rarely came down to the earthly level. So whether it was, you know, in his case, you know, even after the first realization of the first major spiritual experience or the first experience of spiritual reality, the subsequent things were only just a little polishing, a little fine-tuning, a little different shades. Because, you know, otherwise, how do you explain a person just in 3 days he masters all tantras, 3 days he masters all Vaishnava ideas, in 3 days he masters the complete Vedanta sadhana, gets into Nirvikalpa Samadhi, and with great difficulty he had to be brought back. So Tapri says, main 40 saal kyo koshish kiya tha, to 3 din ke andar itna prapt kar liya. So obviously, all these things, you know, point out to a different kind of a spiritual metal or a spiritual framework for Sri Ramakrishna himself. So, in his case, probably, It was, you know, as if, you know, this whole spiritual entity called Sri Ramakrishna is being embellished with the different kinds of ornaments. He was completely whole and spiritually perfect in any mode that he had attempted, even in the beginning. So later on, you know, the other different ideas like, you know, Tantra, Vaishnava, Vedanta, Yoga, whatever it is, even the other religions like Christianity, Islam and all that, they were all like, you know, adding different ornaments to the extraordinarily beautiful person. Supposing there is a very extraordinarily beautiful person, the ornaments can be put on, but they don't completely give a new, totally new look or a new dimension of this thing to that perfection to the person. Person would be very beautiful even without those ornaments. But those ornaments give a little different shade, maybe look slightly differently when wearing those ornaments. If you put on ornaments to a very ugly person, would it make him or her beautiful? No. So basically, because he was endowed with great spiritual beauty, perfection by himself, so whatever was done, you know, they were all just little shades to give a different look, a different beauty, a different kind of an idea about this spiritual personality. So Bhairavi Brahmani was an adept in the heroic mode. The next stage of the Tantra Sadhana, where one has to be extremely careful, stay away from the objects of temptation, etc. Otherwise, you know, there's likelihood of the aspirant coming down, going down the track instead of going up the path. So she was probably a perfectionist. It looks also like, because, you know, she was also endowed with a very wonderful, beautiful form externally. She was quite young. She was alone. But, you know, that's also another thing. You know, a person once is slightly established in spiritual life, they become fearless. She would go all alone, absolutely afraid of, unafraid of anything. That's just like a person who is a true hero. Because she was a follower of the heroic mode of worship, that heroism was there even otherwise in her life. She would always go about, she would never bother. She was never worried about, you know, protecting herself or things like that. Although she was quite young and she was very beautiful to look at, but she was absolutely, you know, because she was so unearthly, she never used to bother about all these earthly enjoyments or this or that. We also saw that incident with Mathur Babu. But then, you know, where exactly was the imperfection in Bhairavi Brahmani? That's what Satma is trying to describe in detail. Although she was established in that, see, from Pasu Bhava, you go to Vira Bhava. And Vira Bhava, ultimately, unless you also attain perfection in the Divya Bhava, your Tantra Sadhana is not complete in all respects. So it was very clear that the Bhairavi Brahmani was not established in the Divya Bhava. As she observed the living example of the divine mode in the master and benefited from his support, the Brahmani gradually developed a desire to achieve that state. Brahmani saw that as soon as the master heard the word Siddhi or Karana, he became overwhelmed with the consciousness of God, the cause of the universe. See, you know, for them, for extraordinary aspirants like Sri Ramakrishna, external support, external means are just mere suggestions. They don't need at all. They just need someone to kindle that supreme state of spiritual awakening in them. Just as, you know, we also know how he saw an Englishman standing near a Bakul tree and immediately he was reminded of Sri Krishna. So everywhere it was like that. Something or other, because, you know, actually, you know, everything in the world, whatever it is, whatever we classify as good, bad, worse or whatever it is, in some way or other, they're all connected to the divine. If you believe that the world is originated from divine, from God himself, whatever may be its final form, it may look the most ugly and the most vulgar and the most kind of a corrupt entity externally. But if you remember the original cause, because it has come from God, obviously, if you have that spiritual sensitivity, even that can remind you of the highest idea of God. Even you used to see, even some of the animals, when they were indulging in very base things, then also you would be immediately reminded, and you would go into samadhi. Why? Because, you know, normally, you know, the more and more we dwell in the realm of the body, our mind concentrates, it recognizes, it gets associated more and more with the bodily things. But the more and more we fine-tune ourselves, it goes more and more into the realm of the spirit. Even anything connected with the body very quickly would take you to the highest level of the spirit, and you are in an altogether different realm of mind. So that is why when people hear that about karan or wine, immediately people think of drinking and getting drunk and dancing and falling down and this and that or whatever it is. But because he know karan, immediately that reminded him of Jagat Karan, the primordial cause about God, and he was in samadhi. So for him, just you need only a suggestion, because he always was aware of the connection between the ultimate, the origin, God or the supreme entity, and its final manifestation in whatever form it was. It was ugly, it was bad, it was despicable for ordinary minds, ordinary words. But really, in a sense, it was nothing but the highest. In fact, you know, even if you look at the things of the world, whatever we look at it externally, whatever may be the form, the best food or the worst waste, if you analyze in terms of elements, they are one and the same. There is no difference. So if you try to go more deeper and deeper into the finer aspects of anything, and ultimately to the real spirit, then obviously there cannot be any difference. Any item in the world you analyze, everything is made up of the five elements only. So if you go on dissecting them, then you find the best rasagulla, the worst dust, the dirt on the roads, both mean one and the same, because both are created of the same elements. So in that sense, both are one and the same. There's no difference. So he was universe. Whenever he saw a woman, whether chaste or unchaste, he remembered the divine mother's powers of creation and of bestowing joy, and felt himself to be her child. Similarly, जब भी कोई महिला को देखा, immediately would remember of the divine mother, her power of creation, how she gave birth to this entire world, mother as the shakti, the power behind all creation, and he would be in raptures, in joy, because he always considered himself to be the child of the divine mother. His hands and limbs recoiled from the very touch of gold and other metals, even when he was asleep. Living near such a spiritual dynamo, what person would not have the passion for God enkindled? What person would not become disgusted with ephemeral wealth and power and the desire to establish a personal relationship with God? We heard that this is why the Brahmani decided to practice severe austerities for the rest of her life. See, any person would have been obviously attracted and turned towards spiritual life, even very ordinary people. But because she herself was a great aspirant, she was a sadhika herself. So living near Sri Ramakrishna, all those things got completely, you know, again like a fire. They were embers, they were just kind of dying. Just a little shake and they started blazing again. And that's why they say to live in the company of great souls or sadhus, in the sense, those who remind you about God, in whose presence you always feel the need for a spiritual life, the need for practice, the need for sadhana. They say that you live in such company. So, in living in the company of the master, very quickly her spiritual sensitivities were again kindled, and she was again in a mood to do sadhana. The master told us that the Brahmani would become jealous if he associated with the other devotees or paid great respect to any saintly person. Now he is coming to the really earthly nature of the Bhairavi Brahmani. See, unless a person is completely perfect in the realm of the spirit, some way or other there will be traces of human nature. In fact, you see, they say, the moment you are born in this world, the moment the earth touches you, some earthly qualities latch on to you. Whatever be, even avatara, that's why they say, you know, that famous incident of Sri Ramakrishna, Bhagavan, after Varaha avatara, he refused to go back to his kingdom. Vishnu said, no, main yahan rahunga, bahut acha hu main. He was playing in mud and he was wallowing and he was quite happy. No, this is what it is, symbolic. Symbolic. The idea is, if you are in this world, just in somewhere or other, some worldly quality, some earthly quality will just get rubbed on to your very personality. Just as Sri Ramakrishna used to say, kajale ghare thakle, kichu na kichu. So like that, because in that matter, the point is, when one becomes more and more spiritually evolved, those qualities are just, they vanish in a trice, just in a moment, in no time. And they don't make a dent into your spiritual realm. They don't affect you spiritually. For example, Swamiji also used to get terribly angry. That kind of anger you and I cannot get. He can scold you and tear you to pieces. That even Raja Maharaj, he scolded him so much. Raja Maharaj simply ran away, shut his doors, and he was weeping profusely. Mind you, Brahmagya Purush, Sri Ramakrishna's Manas Putra, Brahmagyani of the highest order, closing the doors and weeping like a child. Then Swamiji also came running, he knew. And then he came and then he caught hold of him. And then Swamiji was weeping. That was a different issue altogether. The point is, so Swamiji could also get so angry. But what is the difference? Sadur dag, rag jaler dag. Narkel jaler dag, na imni ordinary water. So immediately, in a moment, it would vanish. And it does not affect their spiritual. That's what is important. Whatever they do in this world, it does not affect their spiritual nature. But so here lies the catch. Even ordinary people sometimes, even before reaching the highest heights of spirituality, they start behaving as if they have overcome everything. I said, Jagat tin kaal mein nahi hai. So Sri Ramakrishna used to criticize. You have to be very careful. You have to set an example. You have to be a model before others. And never be sure of yourself. Kyo itna mat mission, itna niyam kanan, kyo banaya? It's not for X, Y, or Z. When you set a tradition, it should be made in such a way that you are always protected. The tradition is protected. The lineage is protected. The ideas are again and again kept intact. So, if a person is really evolved, that's why we have heard people like Trailinga Swami, many others. I mean, they can eat sometimes unimaginable quantities of food and for days together live without food, days together sleeping, months together without sleep. See, many extraordinary physical manifestations, raga, dvesha, hitting, scolding, many things. But these are just very fleeting moments in their life. They don't really affect them very deeply. More importantly, they just don't touch their spiritual personality. But if one is not perfect, Sri Ramakrishna also sometimes, you would say when somebody is bringing jalebis, he used to hide. Nein, kisi ko nahi dunga. Was he attached to jalebis? Does it mean that? Just fun. So, Bhairavi Brahmani, because she was not perfected, manifesting those qualities that only proved that she was yet to reach the highest. So that was affecting her spiritual life. She was feeling jealous. If Sri Ramakrishna used to show respect to others or mix with somebody, she would feel very, very jealous. So he says, we understand that her attitude towards the master was that of a grandmother or an elderly woman relative, who feels distressed on finding a boy she had raised begin to show affection for others in the household as he grows older. I am not very familiar with this. वो कह रहे हैं किसी घर पे किसी को पालन किया, बड़ा किया, वो बड़ा होके किसी के साथ अच्छे व्यवहार करते हैं, किसी को प्यार दिखाते हैं, उसका कोई ईर्ष्या, if that person become jealous, maybe it's all there in the संसार. So, as a highly advanced aspirant, the Brahmani should not have had that feeling. She had the opportunity to observe the master's life day and night for a long period. So she ought to have known that the master's love and respect were not transient, as is often the case with other people. Of course, she was not witness to that at that time. But even during the time, she stayed for some months at Dakshineswar. She must have observed how Sri Ramakrishna was treating others, How was he treating the Holy Mother herself? Someone who is married to him. So, you know, seeing all that, she must have understood how completely detached he was in his dealings. कहाँ जाना है? नहीं चाहते हैं? माँ भी साथे जा, साथ में जा. He was very particular that mother should not accompany him. At the same time, he is not expressing. He is allowing her to decide. No, not only that, the more classic case is the way he dealt with Narendra. For some days, he would come, he would sit and go. Sri Ramakrishna would not even look at him. Previously, it is described how whenever he would come, he would become so restless. He himself would feed him personally, he would take sweets, everything, take him to a separate place and feed him with his own hands. Narendra would become so embarrassed and he would praise him so much in front of others. And then again this behavior where he clearly ignores him day after day. Then again, because he is coming consistently, then he himself asks him, "Are, main to baat hi nahi karta hu tumhari saath, kyun aa rahe ho?" Then he gets the answer. So, you know, clearly proving that his love, his affection is of a different nature. Because, you know, Narendra himself raised this issue. Aap aise Narendra karenge, baad mein to mrityu ke baad jada bharat jisse hua, aapka bhi wahi janam hoga next time. Just as you had the birth of a deer, your condition will also be like that. Then simply he became confused. He ran to mother and came back and said, "Doshala, I will not believe you." Why? Because mother has shown that in you I see Narayana. That is why I love you. Jahan main Narayan ko dekhta hu, isi karan se pyar karta. Otherwise, I will not. The day I cannot see Narayana in you, I will not be able to look at your face. And you know, he was very clear about this also. Two instances where, you know, once he saw, he could not look at Raja Maharaj, who was so dear to him. Itna pyar karte the. He himself used to feel that his mother has shown him as his manas putra. Kyon? Are, kya hua? Then Raja Maharaj accepted. That day, in a playful manner, he had told a lie. Us samay bhi jhoot mat bolna. Don't tell a lie, even in a playful manner. He clearly told him. And Niranjan, when he accepted job somewhere, because it was for money, it was some consideration, Sri Ramakrishna said that I can see clearly a black kind of a coating over your face. So, you know, his sensitivity was so great. So, his love, his affection, his showing that kind of an attitude, everything was completely based on a spiritual attitude, a spiritual revelation. So, that was different. But Vairavi Brahmani, although she was herself a great sadhika, this difference was there. She was feeling jealous like ordinary people in the household, where they would feel jealous if a person becomes close to somebody or shows affection to someone suddenly. She had the opportunity. And then she should have realized that the affection and respect that he rendered to her were permanent without ebb or flow. See, she must have understood. She must have, why she didn't realize? Because master's respect for Bhairavi, that was permanent, because she had taught him some of the very important aspects of Tantra. She told him a different aspect of reality through another path of sadhana. So naturally, why would not Sri Ramakrishna respect her ever afterwards? Somehow she felt a little threatened. And then, "Oh worldly love, you constantly attempt to possess your beloved forever, allowing no freedom from your bonds of love. You think that if your beloved were given liberty, he or she would love you, leave you and find someone else to care for more. You do not understand that it's your own mental weakness that prompts you to feel this way." See, quite often people, you know, imagine, "Oh, mere pyar nahi karta hai." Simply, you know, if you keep on imagining and people suffer. Now, how does a person prove? Is there any physical way in which someone can show, "Main aapke bahut jaya se jaya pyar karta"? How does anyone show? Even if someone brings gifts or gives something and this and that, that may not really mean, he may not have that attitude, but still one can give gifts, bring something and all that. So, you know, it is only when there is a unification of the mental wavelength, where if you genuinely feel towards somebody, it's quite possible that the same would be reflected from the other side also. And moreover, If there is a common bond, if there is a common goal, if there is a common identity, through that only, that is why, you know, why people, why seniors, why sadhus, why mahapurushas, why they again can say that, try to love God and through that you can love everybody. Why? Because if that link is not there, if you don't go via God, wherever you go directly, there is always a question, there is always a chance of the ebb and flow. It will go up, it will go down, it can get broken, it can, there can be misunderstanding, there can be difference of opinion, there can be so many things. But you know, if there is a common linkage, aap bhi Bhagwan ki pyar karte hain, wo bhi karta hai. So then, there is a commonality of interest. Dono se ek saath karte hain, automatically you love each other and there is, that relationship is permanent. That's why, you know, devotees gather, devotees live together, devotees enjoy. In Gita, in every scripture they talk about devotees being together in the company of each other. Why? The commonality of interest. All are interested in the same ideal, same Ishta Devata, same God, same spiritual values. So when you link yourself to the, another person through that idea, that bonding is very firm, is very clear, and there is no personal agenda in it. That is the biggest thing. Normally, you know, in all the forms of love or affection, etc., which we express in the world, there's always an element of give and take. You give something, you expect something. You do something, you feel that the other person would respond in a particular way. And if the expectation is not met, there is sorrow, there is difference of opinion, there is suffering, there is jealousy, there is anger. Every kind of emotional expression takes place. But if the idea is, you know, when you try to love God, there cannot be, the expectation itself is of a totally different nature. And moreover, if it is for a very genuine spiritual pursuit, obviously that transcends all worldly limitations and you are in a different league altogether. And when the other person also approaches God that way, the relationship in between both of you at the level of the earthly level, that will be wonderful, because your only commonality, the only common area of interest between you and the other person is your pursuit of God. And therefore, there is no space for any give and take, and both are equally happy in sharing the glories and the gunavalis and the good qualities of the other virtues of the Lord Himself. So, here in any other, in every other kind of a relationship, however much you glorify it in terms of love or affection or whatever it is, there is always the bondage, because the moment you try to constrict somebody, restrict somebody, then there is always danger of a cleavage, the falling apart. That danger is always there. It seems surprising that although the Brahmani was a highly advanced aspirant and a great devotee, she did not recognize her own weakness or was incapable of accepting it despite an intellectual understanding. In fact, she lacked the awareness of selfless love. So moreover, you know, the matter became even more complicated when she found that she was teaching Sri Ramakrishna. See, the matter, if she had come only to learn from Sri Ramakrishna, probably it would have been easier. Now, once you put yourself in the place of a guru or a teacher, obviously you become even more unaware. There is a greater cloud of ignorance over your understanding, because you think that, hey, main toh uska siksha diya. I am his teacher. What does he know? I know much more. So obviously, her own shortcomings were not very obvious to her, because she was also partly clouded by this feeling that I am Sri Ramakrishna's teacher. Main toh uska, I have taught him all tantras. What does he know? And then, because of that, she was not able to feel. On the contrary, because she had the great fortune to become a guru to Sri Ramakrishna, she slowly came to believe that she was superior to everyone else and others should follow her advice or they would come to harm. Ye bhi sochne laga, main to yahan to sabse bada Sri Ramakrishna hai, main uski to siksha diya, mera adhik kon hai yahan? Because the person who is the lord of this place, I am his guru. So I am the biggest. Everybody should follow me. Otherwise, sab banash ho jabe udhar. That became her. In fact, Holy Mother used to tremble, because she would get so angry. Mother was always a very timid and mild person. She was always afraid. She was even jealous when the master gave instructions to the Holy Mother. Wo bhi nahi chahta tha.
माँ के वो थोड़ा कुछ बताना वो भी शुड ऑब्जेक्ट. We have also heard that the Holy Mother was fearful and meek when she had to face the Brahmani's horrible attitude. Finally, by the grace of the Master, the Brahmani came to realize this weakness of her mind. She understood that under such circumstances, she could overcome this mental imperfection only by staying away from the Master. उन्होंने समझ लिया. मेरा तो previously, see, now the difference is, before coming to Sri Ramakrishna, she had this defect in her. वो गलती तो एक कमती तो उनके अंदर था ही जरूर. It was there in her, but she was not aware of it. She was just keeping it, she was unaware, it was ignorance. Just as, you know, you say there is some kind of a purity in the children. Yes, purity to hai. But then unless the child grows, all the hidden sanskaras are manifest, then the child does sadhana as a young person, overcomes it, realizes the goal, then only the life is perfect. One cannot be a child all the time. Being a child is not being a brahmagyani. It's a kind of an indication of what might happen if you are a realized soul. Because there also a tinge or a hint of that purity or that perfection is there. But then most of the things are lying hidden, unexpressed, unexplored. So as a person grows older, these sanskaras start coming out. And that is where sadhana comes into place. People do sadhana, realize the goal, and then they reach a greater perfection. What was dormant, what was just by chance, without expression, in the young person or the child, as a grown-up sadhaka who had achieved something, that would be clear because they have gone through the hard way, hard path, conquered all the passions, conquered all the impurities, and then become perfect. So in the same way, Vairavi Brahmani had this defect, but she was not aware. Jankari nahi tha. When she came to Sri Ramakrishna, she understood that the sannidhya, the nearness of Sri Ramakrishna, brought out clearly the difference between her own life and what was in Sri Ramakrishna, the perfection. Then also she understood that now the only remedy is for me to go away from this place. Because staying near him, I am constantly becoming jealous, becoming annoyed, becoming envious of others. So, dur hatke, main sadhan karke, I will. Because she was a very determined spiritual aspirant, she decided, in fact, she spent rest of her life probably in Varanasi somewhere and doing great austerities. I think dusri baad mein bhi ek bar the Sri Ramakrishna probably saw her when he went on a pilgrimage to Benares or some other place, if I remember correctly. A monk is she felt that her attitude and attraction to the Master was like being bound with a golden chain, and that she needed to cut it in order to move forward towards her cherished goal. There is a saying among itinerant monks, a monk who is pure, who goes, and the water that is pure, that flows. So, if you are in all the place, you kind of stagnate. If you keep moving, and then much of the impurities also wash away. The Brahmani therefore gave up the Master's company and left Dakshineswar to spend her days traveling to various holy places and practicing austerities. However, it was the Master's help as a guru that the Brahmani reached that understanding. So this is the final crowning piece of the whole episode, that she came, she helped Sri Ramakrishna in her own little way, and in turn, the imperfection in her got perfected through the contact and the instruction and the awakening that Sri Ramakrishna brought about in her. That is one chapter is over. Now another, because mainly he discusses two great aspirants. One is his Bhairavi Brahmani and his Sotapari. Although Sri Ramakrishna, he did it to many others, to aspirants, his gurus, disciples. For example, when the Jatadhari came, Jatadhari was so fond of this Ramlala. He would take him wherever he went. He would so ritualistically worship, offer everything. Then finally, when he came to Sri Ramakrishna, he found that Jatadhari was more fond of Sri Ramakrishna. It was constantly with him. It had left Jatadhari and Ramlala became a companion of Thakur. So he was going and playing and he was getting into waters, everything. And he was, when the time came, this Ramlala was not ready to go. So he became so upset initially. But then slowly he understood that, you know, previously to worship that Ramlala, he needed that external image to concentrate, to do dhyana, to have that idea, that bhava, that he is a worshipper of Ramlala. Then he said, my object of worship is permanently with me. I don't have to carry him physically everywhere. Through the grace of Sri Ramakrishna, by coming in contact with Sri Ramakrishna, he had completely realized, reached such a state of mind that he felt that Ramlala was always Amisha uske saath rahana shuru kar diya. So there was, see, if you keep something physically, there's always a danger of its being lost or someone taking away. But then if he's established in your heart, wo to Amisha ke liye raha sakta hai. He was always ever present in his heart. So apparently, although he had to part with the vigraha of Ramlala, the real Ramlala, the spirit, that was permanently embedded in the heart of Jatadhari. So in his case also, it was a case of fulfillment. Because otherwise he was completely getting caught in that rituals and doing that worship and offering and everything and all that. And this was even a more elevated, a more refined way of worshipping Ramlala. Now he talks about this Tothapuri. Tothapuri, you'd always call him as Nangta, because no, he never used to wear any cloth. Because the idea is, they used to feel one with the very existence itself. Only when you feel any distinction, you know, as a man, woman, body, everything, if a person is completely beyond all that, beyond any kind of duality, then, you know, anything that is brought in is an aberration, is a limitation on the idea of the ultimate or the unitary consciousness or that kind of an idea. So deliberately, they just cast away everything, including the dress. In fact, you know, even Sri Ramakrishna, many times when he used to go and do dhyana and the panchavati and all that, he would remove all that, even his sacred thread, his clothes, everything. Why? Because, you know, it's symbolic, the cloth that we wear is a symbol of the bondage that we experience. In some way or other, why this bondage? The bondage that I am the body. I have to cover my body. I have to keep myself. I am different. I am man. I am woman. I am this. I am young. I am old. All these things are only limitations. If one is aware that one is only pure consciousness, the body is nothing then. Supposing there is a log of wood. No one goes and puts trousers to a tree, because we know that it has no meaning. Similarly, if your own body, if you say that your body has no meaning for you, you are only consciousness all the time, you will never think of wearing any clothes. So true Paramahamsas, that's why Sri Ramakrishna also, he would never care. He was just, quite often you would be without clothes. But no one would used to feel that he's not wearing any clothes. That is why, you know, if a person is so advanced in spiritual life, it would often, you know, it would evoke that kind of a spiritual response from others. That is very important. If one is spiritually evolved, dusre ka dekhne mein pata chalna chahiye. Oh, he is really evolved. He is different. Otherwise, you know, nobody, people, so many visitors used to come, important people. This, no one used to feel that Sri Ramakrishna was not wearing a cloth. Then definitely, in the sadharan samaj mein toh isa sochenge, what is this ungentlemanly act? But when they see Sri Ramakrishna, they would always, you know, in the descriptions in Kathamrita, you'll always get like a panch varsh balak jaise, like a small child of 4 or 5 years. No one looks at a child with that kind of an eye, because it has no idea of body, no idea of sex. So where is the question of dress for such a child? Similarly, so this Tothapuri was also an established Brahmagyani, so to say, who had practiced so hard. He was belonging to the Nag tradition, Tothapuri. So the Naga Sampradaya, sannyasins, he never used to wear cloth. Naga monks worship the Dhuni. So Obi Amesha Dhuni rakhte te pas mein. He would always keep, he had only a small water pot, a thick chadar to cover his body in terms of winter, etc. And then a pair of tongs, chimta kate hain, wo sab aag uthane ke liye to take something from this and that. Nothing else, no other belongings. And you would never stay inside a closed room. Okay, again, the idea is, you know, deliberately, wherever there is an idea for limitation, bondage, they will try to stay away. Staying inside a room is a bondage. Go open into the air, you are one with the akasha, you are one with the infinite, you are one with the very existence. So you'd always stay right under the skies without any roof, without any bondage, without any limitation. So you'd always stay by the fire, and at midnight you would get up and stoke the fire, add some firewood, and then sit in dhyana. For hours together, like a log of wood, he would meditate, absolutely unaware of the external world. Sometimes also even during daytime, he would cover his body with a chadar and he'll be simply lying. People think that he might be sleeping, but he would always be in a state of deep absorption. Because, you know, actually, why people also, most of us, why we need so much of food, so much of rest, so much of all that is because because of our body-mindedness, body consciousness. Even you become more and more into the realm of spirit, much less food, much less rest, much less thing. Because, you know, when you are in the level of the body, the mind is so distracted. It is constantly engaged in activity. It's terribly restless. And out of that restlessness, it becomes tired. If the mind, supposing, you know, you are in a particular place, you are sitting quietly, you are not tired at all. But if you are running here and there, constantly walking, you become tired in no time. Similarly, the mind also, if it is completely allowed to go into a state of rest, not sleep, then such a mind is always fresh. And you don't need too much of sleep or too much of other nourishments for the body. So, you daytime also, you would completely be absorbed. You'll be lying down, but you'd be in meditation. Tota's only possessions were a water pot, pair of long tongs, an animal skin for seat, and thick chadar to cover his body. Every day, he would polish the water pot. It was pital katha. He would brightly polish it and it would be shining. So, one day, of course, a very famous incident, all of you know. Every day he was meditating so many hours. So, Sri Ramakrishna asked him, "What is this? You are such a realized soul. Why have you to meditate so much?" Then he pointed out to that water pot. "Dekho, har roz saaf karta. Sili itna chamak raha. It's so bright because I polish it every day. You allow it to lie like that, it becomes dirty, no time." Sri Ramakrishna accepted, but immediately said, "No, he was such an intelligent person. Mana sone ka koi bartan. That you don't have to wash." It touched Totapuri's mind, this observation. See, there are, you know, the difference is Ramakrishna was like a sone ka bartan and he was like a pital. Totapuri, that was the difference. He needed constant practice, but Sri Ramakrishna, because he was like a spotless gold, he was always shining. But of course, you know, although Sri Ramakrishna said that is true, but even, you know, aap sone ke bhi kuch, you keep it like that aside, after 2-3 months, it will also become dirty. Only thing is, in that case, cleaning is very easy. Aap sahaj mein ho, thoda uski saaf karein, to again it will shine. Whereas pital, if you keep it like that a few days, it will become so spoiled, you have to throw it. You cannot clean it at all. So, there is a difference between aspirants and sadhakas and siddha purushas and realized souls. So, he said that it was not necessary in Sri Ramakrishna's case. This was permanently imprinted in Totapuri's mind. Totapuri realized that the master's mind was indeed as bright as a golden water pot. From the very beginning, the guru and the disciple had many such intellectual exchanges. So we shall continue this next time. Because again, you know, he is explaining in detail how, by the grace of Sri Ramakrishna, by coming in contact with him, how Totapuri also reached a state of perfection. I think the entire rest of the chapter is devoted to that. And then he goes to Guru Bhav part 2. Probably we can finish this next week itself, if necessary. It's on 20th. Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Tat Sat Sri Ramakrishna Arpanamastu.